go. Dave Tough was the most highly revered jazz player. Played Woody Herman and Tommy Dorsey and all kinds of bands. In recent years, one of the most sought after big band drummers and head of his own band was Mel Lewis. Well, Mel Lewis, by his own admission, couldn't play the drums at all. Couldn't he roll like this? But when the music started, heaven, right? Did everything right. So think about, even in the rock field, think about the guys that are really making it. A lot of them are not huge soloists. They're not the greatest technicians in the world. But they get the job done because they pay attention to what's happening with the rest of the band, and they fill they're role players, like a basketball team. They're not all Dr. J's and Michael Jordan's. Got to be guys in there to pass off and to rebound and do all that stuff. So what I do might be flashy, and you're going to be surprised that an old man can play this way. It's just something that was taught to me, passed to me 50 years ago on a silver platter. And it doesn't mean that every other way of playing is invalid. Just because I've survived, it's that I'm not shaking up my central core very much at all when I'm playing. What's happening is out in here. It means it's I'm not really playing in like that. I'm playing out there, somewhere out in front of me, because I've been taught that way. And I'll show you how to do it, mainly. Did anybody bring a pad? I've asked people to bring pads if they wanted to. Anybody bring a pad? No. All right. Well, I'm going to have some of you reluctantly, perhaps, but anyway, I would, and maybe eagerly, come up here sometime and I'm going to try to give you a little lesson in the molar system, but that's not all I'm going to do with it. Were any of you here a couple of years ago when I was here? Weren't? Fine. Okay. Well, that's good. Then I'm not going to be redundant. So I'm going to, everybody says, drum clinicians, well, I'm going to play a little. I'm going to play a little, very little at first, but I'm going to demonstrate some things on the drums. First, I'll just kind of find out how the drums sound, all right? Walt Johnson, Walt Johnson, not the pitcher, Walt Johnson of Pure Cushion, always walks by me when I've been doing these things in the booth or something. Garbage, Jim, he says. Now.
Change a few things here. I'm going to play this on the table. I'll tell you, I just want to put the pad on this. Could I put the pad on that? Come on. Okay. Now,
obviously, that didn't kill me, you know, it didn't kill me to play like that. And the reason it didn't kill me, because it's a very easy thing for me to do that, because I'm not involving my body. When I'm playing a fast triplet, for instance, I'm not going one, 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 I'm going one. And what am I doing? I'm really throwing the stick at the pad. Now, that doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with playing like this. It's more accurate. If you're a symphonic player and you're playing, but when you're really wailing, this thing doesn't work too well. The wrist hinge here doesn't work all that well. So what you do is you get it around, put it in my lap. Sorry, I can do it from here. What am I doing? What's different than this? This is 1-1-1-1-1-1-1-1-1-1. See, my arm is being shaken up a little bit, transferring a little bit up here. Now, just for this is great for tapping. Nothing the matter. I can get my fingers under here. Even better is the French, for tapping is a French timpani method. That's a great way of tapping. Not a good way of accenting. So what you do is you use the tools that you need at that moment. If you're doing crescendos and you want to play that snare drum style, and you got the snare drum facing towards you, playing match grip, and you're playing like that, it's great. But it's not the same thing as accenting. You're going to go around the drums, more like this. You're not going to go, because you can't make the accent from in here. So you move out to here, and you throw the stick at the pad. Not one, 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 but this. Making one motion. Actually, for somebody like at my age, what it does is help your circulation. Now the droop, only reason for the droop, that's great. All right. Beautiful, that's a good height too. Now, most of the time, I play traditional grip. Traditional grip is great, but it makes you play one side of the drum set. Understand? If you want to play, if you want to play the cymbal up, you're not. If you want to do a Simon Phillips, this doesn't work too well if you're playing traditional. But traditional grip is a lot of fun, and you feel that you're part of history. You're marching in the Army of Northern Virginia with some kid, 14 years old, and he's 109 pounds, and he's 5'11", and he's trying to play these things, and he's playing on a rope drum that may be a little soggy, and he's trying. So it has a history, and the way that I play is very similar to what those guys developed. There have been four times in history that I know, in American history, where there's an enormous load put on the drummers. One, obviously, marching in war. You're playing, and the sergeant's yelling at a kid, play something. Don't sit there and go blap, blap. You're playing this drum over here, and you're holding the stick like this because the stick is very heavy. You're not holding it like this. Second thing. Circus performers play a three-hour show, man. They got an old bass drum, 28-inch bass drum, and a single tension snare made of wooden rims, and a little single cymbal up here, an old really Chinese tom-tom, really, that probably in soggy weather, so, but in good weather, it's a bong, you know, and you're catching all these acts all over the thing, and your circuit, and the elephants come in, you go boom, 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 ding, ding, and you go boom, bing. You got to roll, have to get a roll like this and a roll like this. You got to get all kinds of heavy work. That's number two. Number three, swing era. After Gene Krupa, everybody wanted to hear a drum solo. If you were a bad drum soloist, you still made you play drum solos. And that was, you know, you have to really bust yourself. But the most energetic of all is the rock era. You really, so this technique is superb for this particular task, because you choose whether you're gonna play out at the end of your string or not. You know, if you want, doesn't you, if you can, you can play if I'm singing something like this. The accent, I'm doing nothing. The crack is coming down in this soft part of my hand rather than across the knuckles like this with a thumb stick, you know, if you don't play match grip. If you play match grip, same thing, it's a motion. See? In motion. Now, if I can be tight, I can be a little tighter. See that little motion, that little flick? That's the secret. Now, you've seen a lot of guys do that. Slow. You've seen Anton Figg recently studied with Kenny Aronoff. Not really, but he studied with Kenny Aronoff. Kenny Aronoff's doing this. That's nothing but what I'm doing here, right? A big version. Now, what it looks like, the great thing about what Moeller taught was you do exactly the same thing fast as you do slow. So the reason he analyzed how these guys play, because a lot of people don't play at all the way they say they play, you know. One guy came to me and said, Jim, says, I play triplets almost as well as you do. I said, you probably play them just as well. He said, well, I don't play them anything like you, you know. I studied with this New York teacher that will be nameless. He said, and I play them like this. I said, what do you mean? I play them all wrist. You got to watch this, because in my hands are like this. I'm playing right down this line here. This line is this. See the bent wrist there? Play them all wrist. See what happens when you get fast? This is a point being that very few people know how they actually play. They tell you how they were taught, and then but they don't tell you about the adjustments they made, right? I said, go faster. He said, okay. That's not what he was doing before. That wasn't 1-1-1-1-1-1-1-1. This is what he's doing over here. This is what he's doing over here. 1-1-1-1-1-1-1. Just the motion, see? And nobody knows it. That's the funny part of it. Nobody knows it exactly. Vinnie Colaiuta invented the system for himself. He knew all the guys that he studied with, he studied with the same guys, J.R. and Steve Smith and a few other guys studied. They never got that. Somewhere in history, Vinnie Colaiuta decided that he was going to play fast and he was going to accent strongly. And he invented it for himself. So it's nothing, it's not a big mystery. I never would have got it myself, because I came late to the game, and I would when I went to Moeller, I was like this, just like this. Very much. Moeller said, kid, you play terrible, don't you? You know, this is this old man I'm talking about. Did you get these sheets, by the way? And has everybody got these sheets? Beautiful, good, okay. So he made me, for a month, he made me do practically this. Watch. But then, contrary to what some people are teaching now as a kind of an adjunct of the Moeller system, the important thing is not merely that, it's the fact that you hit and get back. Because what happens naturally is you go, you do three, say three is the most natural thing. It's like hand-to-hand motion, the most natural is, can't think of any more natural hand-to-hand motion. When you get five, it's not five, but three, so here's what you're doing. Now, the stick makes you do it. If you throw, okay, that's it. Makes you do it. But if you analyze it and slow it down and take it apart It's like you had suddenly had a car, and your car didn't run too well, but your friend's a mechanic. He says, give me the car, babe. Give me the car. The car sounds terrible. He says, I said, the car sounds all right. Go 60 miles an hour. What do I need? He said, it shakes a little at 60. Go a little faster, okay. So he says, give it to me. So he takes the car, and when he gets the car, it's like, papa to poopa ta to ta ta to ta 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 ta. He brings it back 2 days later, and he goes, you take it on the highway, it feels pretty good, and you put your foot down where it usually was going up to 60 miles an hour. You're cruising along, you look down, going 90 miles an hour. You don't know why. Because that's what happened to me. I gave my hands to Moeller, and he said, okay. And he's like a mechanic, and he said, okay, do this. And I was a 19-year-old kid, and I'd been playing only a year and a half, but I played terrible. You know, I could keep time and things, but as far as technique, and I thought it was fast. I had none of that sound, you know. So he said, okay, here's what you do. So he see this thing? He took that apart. He said, down. He said, okay, getting a good rebound now. You're getting a good rebound. Your hand's not young. You don't want this, you want it back. See what he saw? He didn't want to see this either. That extended the wrist hinge too much. There's nothing wrong with the wrist hinge down in here. But the wrist hinge up in here when you're doing this will carpal you to death someday. You know, carpal syndrome. You heard that the tunnel syndrome. What happens is that if this hinge does not work too well that way for a long time, especially, you know, 50 years, it doesn't work that well. So we come to here, neither Jay Burns Moore, another teacher of the day, who was also a giant of a teacher. I'll talk to you a little bit more about him in a minute. Moeller made this whip, right? But then he analyzed it. Down, tap. Now, was strange. Something strange about the third. Watch when I do it fast. Something strange about that third hit, isn't there? I'm coming down. My hand's coming down, right? Don't think about this being down and this and up. That is down and this is up, and the nomenclature is fine. But in the Moeller, in the way Moeller taught it, he's talking about the hand. Hand goes down, and there's a tap. It stays there. All this was, it was an analysis of what happens naturally when you go fast. So here he comes up. Bring your hand up. Down, tap, up. That's what I did down here. Look, what do you see? The shadow of this stick. The shadow of this stick is at the top. See, not much, a little bit down there, but mostly. So if it's going to stop anywhere, it's not going to go. It's going to go. Well, you take it apart, and it's what it looks like. Now, I don't expect you to do this. There's a on the second page here. There's a vision of this. Of course, it's going to look backwards. No, I'm going to do match grip. It's going to look right. Okay. I'm going to do it. I'm going to start with my left hand. This is what you will see if you look in the mirror. See, this is how thorough he was. Don't have to pay attention to this, but I mean, I just want to show you. Just want to get you an idea of what he put me through, you know. But only 7 months. Took two lessons a week for 7 months, and by the time I came out the other end, I had the same amount of chops I have today. Couldn't, not the independence, but just in doing these things, you know. Same amount, 7 months. See that stupid, look at this, page two, that stupid thing. You see those little pictures beforehand, it's gonna be like this. That's what I'm gonna start left hand, right? Does that look more like it now? It looked like that picture. Can you all understand where I am now? Okay. Don't have to do this. This is. I taught when I taught Roy Burns, when I taught Casadas, when I taught Jake Hanna, when I taught Jake Hanna had some of this. When I taught Frank DeVito, I didn't do all these things, you know. But I should have. It's really a. Now you see my left hand is not up like this. My left hand, you see the back of my hand, because he wanted that position of strength. They want both. They didn't want to see this. Then we'll go. One. You know? That's why it's so great for Rob, man. J.
jazz, it wasn't necessary. You're playing with a piano trio, you're not thinking, oh. But if you're playing with a rock band, oh, back, back, oh, back, you know, the greatest thing in the world. Because you're not doing, oh, you're going, you know? The motion. And it shakes blood into your arm and keeps you going. Now, this is not a substitute for the way you're playing now. This is an addition. It might be an addition. Might try it and see. See if it helps in certain ways. There's nothing the matter with any of these ways of playing at certain parts. This is great for tapping. Hard accent unless you're back in. Remember Joe Brancato? Was he here? Any of you here? Okay. Now, is he still here? Now, he plays more or less like this, which is sort of a derivative of the French timpani. If you're tapping, he's down in here, but when he gets loud, now that's mainly the same thing backhand. You understand? If you hit a backhand in tennis, it's beforehand. Beforehand of the ground. Now watch this again. You want to go back to that again? All right, now watch this. It's going to go right down to very quick without any change in the actual. And there's no shifting of gears. Like I shifted gears from here. I had to go to this, you know. I had to go to this to get fast. You don't have to go anywhere from this. Watch. Down. Okay, see where I'm at? That's talking about the hand coming down. Not the tip. The hand down. See where I am now? Now I'm going to hit that left hand arrow pointed up. See that left hand? That black arrow pointed up? Okay. Up. What? Now you see where I am now? Tap. You see where I am now? I'm ready to hit that left hand accent.
Okay, I'm ready to hit that left hand accent now.
Thanks.
Okay. I got to get this out of the way when I play, though. So what am I going to do? I don't know. All right. Down. Up. Tap. You see where I am now? Okay, this is how ridiculous it was. You don't have to do this. You just get this nice feeling without it. But it's interesting. Just if you see this, you have this with you and you say, what the hell did he mean by this? Okay, I'm explaining what I meant by this. All right, we start from the beginning again, okay? Down, up, tap, okay? I'm sorry, I actually got to start from this position, right? Down, up, tap. Down, up. Down, up, tap. Don't forget, I don't play this way. I play traditional grip because I got so good at it. But if somebody asks me, you're going to start with traditional grip or match grip? I'd say match grip. So here I am, I'm doing nothing. One. I'll slow it down. And I'm back at the beginning. See what it is? Down, up, tap. So one hand's doing this. Right? Now, don't make a big, oh, that's it, but kind of, see your right wrist there? Try not to get this feeling, trying to get like a, almost like, not this, not rolling out like that, but rolling out like that. Understand? Not bent, either a little bent in or straight. So that means you can come up like this rather than come up and kind of half show the stick. They didn't want to, Moeller didn't want to see any of your hands when you're playing loud. He did Burns more, especially when you're accenting. See, This only holds true for accent. It's so much better for accent, you won't believe it. If I do it. So you're throwing. That motion. Now, the guys with the pad, just take your, if you're playing traditional, you might want a little slant this way, because this, because otherwise his hand's down underneath you, kind of. What are you going to ask? For the motion, what you doing? Just exactly what you're doing. That's it. But don't get too far underneath. That's what happened in the Moeller book. I said, I bought your book, Mr. Moeller, when I first went to him. He said, Jim, I wish you hadn't bought the book. The book's all wrong, because it had those damn pictures in it with it. And in Krupa, in the Life magazine in about 1939, had these pictures of him doing this. Big exaggeration, because Moeller made a few mistakes in his day. You know, he exaggerated this upstroke. He fell in love with this hit. This one. Understand? The third one there? He fell in love with that. Absolutely fell in love with it. So he was like, instead of, the only reason for it is to get back in the snapping position. Only reason is to get back in the snapping position. Whip. See the whip? And you've got to accept the rebound. You can't go. Everybody, all those old swing drummers, like, well, mostly black drummers, like Joe Jones and Philly Joe, they did this, but they didn't accept the rebound, so it was like this. Rather than. Nice thing about this is that you're not doing anything, so you can crowd all kinds of stuff in there. Okay, that's fine. Oh, that's good. Yeah. So you can crowd all kinds of things in there. See that? I'm here and I'm going fairly brisk clip, but I got all this freedom. Because my arms aren't doing it. And suddenly, if you felt my arms would be very loose, except for that minute, it'd go zoop. It'd be like somebody sent an electric shock through my arm. So the snare. Those are little four-stroke roughs, and they come from a slightly different technique, which is called the pull-out. But this is the basic thing. This is like a dance in midair. Man, you can do this thing so fast, it's incredible. Like, anytime you want to stop me and ask a question, what my act is not can be interrupted at any moment. You know. So this. See, that's one hand, one at a time. Now, the flyback happens naturally when you go fast. The only reason that I do this slow is to set up the idea that you're going to get away from the pad, that you're going to get this, that the throw, is, and you throw this coming down, and tip goes back automatically. But, understand, not like this, but. See how the tip comes back, and see how easy it is to slip those little things in there? Yeah. That's right. Why? Because guys were marching with the drummer over the left-hand side here, and if you played like this, well, your arm would drop off. So really, really, you're kind of. I don't criticize traditional players. They have a certain feeling that they want to be one with history. You know, that's the only great advantage I think that brought by the idiot savants of early rock. That's the, you know, Ringo and Dave Clark and Charlie Watts hardly played the drums at all. But you know, they were heroes, but for me, because at least they started match grip, which is very good. Yeah, and I knew some drummers that played match grip before that. There was a great trumpet player who played drums also named Roy Eldridge, and I heard him play drums playing match grip, and he was absolutely marvelous. He played great. Of course, he played trumpet out of sight. He was one of the three or four great trumpet players in history. He, Louis Armstrong, Roy Eldridge, and then Dizzy, and then Miles, and a few great ones now, Freddie Hubbard, and a lot of Marcellus. And okay, anyway. But he played match grip early on. So really, if you don't really feel the tradition of drums, and you're not really feeling, oh boy, I want to be in the same, I want to be Buddy Rich-ish, and I can see how Vinny feels. I can see how Dom feels. Dom is a, you know, well, you heard Dom, you know what he can do. It's ridiculous. He plays the same things with his feet as I can play with my hands, you know. And a lot of the things that he does are, he felt more comfortable playing traditional, because I heard him play, he played very good match grip. He used to play, he was out on a tour with Simon Phillips about a few years back, and he played match grip great. You know, he had a setup like that, but then he went back to mostly traditional. But he plays both ways. But let me explain again now. This is what this looks like when it's just floating. This is what it looks like slow. I showed you how it looked in that ridiculous thing that Moeller made you do. But here's what it looks like slow. Just play your own triplet, right? Play your own triplet. You're accenting in your own way. And then just play your own with a little push accent like this, you know? And then if you either play traditional or matched. And here's the little push accent. Now I'm going to watch my elbows. You'll see what happens now. Watch the back of my hand. That's it. Now, if you look in the mirror, what you're going to see is the greatest thing of all. Look in the mirror for all these exercises, right? They're beautiful exercises, but they're very simple. But accept the rebounds. When they talk about fly back, They don't mean this. They mean just let the stick fly. Can you see what I did? See how still my hand is after I did this? The reason, yeah, that's perfect, perfect. See what you're doing there? No too big an upstroke. Don't get down in there. That's where Moeller hated that after a while. If you got down under there, he said, God, that's just like my book, Jim. That's terrible. See, not down, because watch what happens. When you way down in there, you can't make the downstroke in a hurry. Watch this. What is that? Up, down, right? I'm doing bub up and then up, down. That's why it goes so fast. You know, it's always aim over here. Right? B3. I'll do it slow. Triplet. These are just the basic parts of book two, because and when I say basic, it means that many other people have been whole books written on each of these subjects. Jim Blackley of Canada has a great couple of books, Syncopated Roles, which deal with a lot of this stuff. But it takes a couple of books to do it in. But you can save a little money by taking this page and running syncopation through it, and it helps your hands and helps your reading, helps everything at once, you know. Now, here I'm going to do the triplet. I'm going to do this inside a triplet. As I say, Gene made a living doing this. Now, I'm sure you realize that there's a note in there that isn't ever played for an accent if you're reading eighth notes, and that's the note in the middle, the triplet note in the middle. It's basically going. When you're playing jazz, this fits very well with jazz, because it's bam ba doo ba doo ba doo ba doo ba doo ba doo ba doo. There's that middle note there that you don't play. No less. So you can't play it, but if you're playing a thing like this, you're mainly playing, you're accenting from the first two notes. So generally, the accenting patterns. I play a bunch of eighth notes. And the middle note doesn't count. That middle note's just that little throwaway. And you can see what the pattern is. If it's anywhere in the first part of the measure, the first beat of the measure, it's with the right hand. Every place within the second beat of the measure, it's with the left hand. Third beat, right hand. Fourth beat, left hand. But you can. I'll do it very slowly just to show you what happened. Look at top of page 9. 1, 2, 3, 4. Right, left, right, left. Right, left, right. Left, left, right, left. Right, left, left. Right, left, left. Left, right, left, left. You see, understand it? You know that. Okay. It's not a big deal, but I just thought if somebody didn't understand it, say, somebody, I've come to people, I can't play those things, Jim. I said, look, you've got to get the feeling that it's written only. That's really all it is. Now, and then, of course, in the buzz roll, I'm coming out of the buzz roll. I could do pushes out of the buzz roll. One. I get it. I'm getting hit. I'm doing hits out of the buzz roll. No, there's not. And then, of course, out of the Scholastic open. And of course, look at, go back to page 7 again. And the 16th notes are nothing. You're all accenting on one side, except when I go back to the top again and show you something else. But C1 is just, here's the rhythm. Or you can do it left hand. And with a buzz roll. Or with the Scholastic open roll. Etc., you know? Now, I'll just play a couple of bars of this because you understand there's nothing to it. Top of page 9. Or the buzz roll. Or the Scholastic over. Understand that? Same with the left hand. Now, look, here we get to the fun of the thing now. Top of page 7, A1B. All this is now. This is you take these things and these are great because they develop one hand at a time. Right? See, because the fill-ins get very fast, you know. Okay, now here's where Buddy made his living. Look at B1B, right? He didn't usually play them with that long in between because it's a little wearing. But he'd usually go, if he did that, but he used to play this all that thing all the time. Now I'll go to the other page. I go, huh? That was B1B. Now I'll show you how fast this can be done with just the first three bars, but there's a long spot there, so I'm not going to play that. I'll just play the first three bars. But I'll play it now, and I'll show you because how it builds up your left hand. Understand that. Now that is not as hard as now. If you really want something hard, look at C 1B. Sometimes than I can right now. I don't know why, but I haven't been playing match grip much. Now this is, here it is. Here's the same thing in nine. Page nine, same style. How hard it is? Really, you don't have to do it that fast, can be. Interesting thing, but these are fakes now. But listen to this. Same thing, but it happens that I have long enough little bursts of open buzzes. Not bad. I'm doing not as well as I do it to traditional grip, but okay. You understand that now. All these exercises over here are combinations of, you can use combinations of, you'll see some strange looking things in the switching hands part. But if you look up here in the corner, it says training for these things. And on page 10, see page 10? This is, Bruce Gaylor did study with me for a while, and he showed me a few different things himself. He said, I got all these exercises that Buddy does a lot of things switching hands. And I said, yeah. And he says, well, why don't you teach people to switch hands? And I said, you do it so well. So I wrote these exercises out, and which are partly stolen from him. But and so it's some people, when they do a four-stroke rough with a triplet. they have a hard job leading with the left hand. Exercises to do that. We're not going to run through the whole thing, but I'll show you the hard ones. This is the way it starts out. You just start out like one, two. And some people have a hard job to switch and still lead. But this is a great thing of if you can do it, why you can improvise your rear end. Matter which hand. See, it doesn't doesn't matter which hand you lead with. And it's very it's a nice, nice. Now we get to the crux of the matter down here, which is very strange, believe me. I want you to look at 3A. I don't like this exercise very much, but I wrote it, so I have to play it. 3A, you see what happens in the second bar? Now, what is that? You understand what that is? It's the triplet starting the offbeat. But if you look up in the corner of the right thing, that's really what it is, but you're spreading it out. You're going da pa da bo ba 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 da pa da ba. But this is going sha ta 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 ta. So if you think of it that way, you can get through it, you know. If I'm going to play it the way it's written, then I'll play it how to learn it. Now I'll play it. I'll play it not in triplets, but you understand what I mean? It's really that. But if you spread it out, then it sounds. But when you play those things fast, it sound. You've heard guys do it before, but you know what they're doing. Then it gets a little bit really hairy, but still it's only that style that you see up in the right hand corner, altered. Everybody do things like these are things. I'm just gonna play. I'll play it with the accent on 1 and 3. That's the accent on 2 and 4. Now, everyone. Let's play another part. I'll play the upside down. Play the backbeat. The ands. Start on the fifth line. Now here's with a double time feel, like a half or half time feel. I'll play from the top again. Thing, you build your left hand up, and you're not playing something too boring. You know, if you sit there and improvise like that, you do it also as you look over on the left hand side. You see, you also do these things in shuffle. Some of them don't work too well in shuffle, but this works great. I did most of the things in that. Now, I'm going to improvise with these things, with the next one, because you don't really need to hear me read these things. You just want to get the idea of what you're doing. Same thing with the triplets. I'll play the example for you first. Triplets, flat triplets. What's good about this method? That's why I got independence. That's why it was nobody was doing it, and all I had to do was one hand was divorced from the other, because I had played these things with the old man. Done these. And he said he wanted to look at my left hand alone, and I'd add the right hand. I said, why add the same thing? Add something different. So I started a little thing. And after a while, I saw that I could do anything with the other hand. Five against 12, I guess that, isn't it? So these things, that's why you don't want to get your body too much into these things. If I'm like this, then it says, what am I going to do over here? I want this happening by itself. You get something going all by yourself. Things start to happen for you. See, and my problem is that I was very stupid. All those years, some people are terminally dumb, but they're very, very smart. I'm smart, but I'm terminally dumb in some ways. And the way I'm terminally dumb is that I spent my life playing with crap music. You understand? There were years where I'd play this. This is practically what I did entirely, because I'd play with idiot leaders, and they wanted this, what they wanted. There's a band called Lester Lannan, was famous among the society people. Nobody else ever heard of him. He paid a lot of money but you had to do that. Well, that's ridiculous. But I also went out with him. I played those jobs, but I also went out and played drum solos once in a while. There's a rock thing happening. About 20 years ago, where these society bands would hire one or two rock musicians, and they have half an hour. Now, that's no longer. They have real rock bands, because nobody that goes out wants that music anymore, really, except at the very highest society, like Prince Ranier and his daughters or something. And they think that's she or something. That old style thing. The songs are great, but the way they play them is like dancing in the dark. Ya da 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 da, ba 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 da 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 da. They played ad infinitum, but I spent my life doing things like that. Played for strippers for years. You know, I should have been out trying to. It was fun. I played the drums. At least it was you played the drums then. But if you're in a peculiar position now. You make a lot more money as a drummer than you ever did before. If you get lucky. But you're not necessarily the best drummers in the world do it, you know. And so, as I was told you about, the role players do it. Vinny's lucky. Dave Weckl is lucky. Because they are great players that knew how to promote themselves. You know. Now, you know this other guy. How many guys do you know that are sensational, that would blow any of the top... The drummers in the top 40 bands in my top 40, but in the 30 or 40 bands, how many players do you know that really are can't do any more than they're really doing. Think about it. And how many guys do you know that are friends of yours that would absolutely stomp them out of the room if they sat down, you know, right? So a lot of the thing is self-promotion these days. And you have to learn how to do that. Some people just are incapable of doing that. I was lucky in a way that because I was in New York, and I got to play with a lot of people. But I never made a lot of money in this business, but I had more fun, and all my sons became became musicians. And they had intellectuals and writers and sculptors and novelists and everything in my family. And three out of my first four sons became musicians. Why did they do that? Said, Dad seemed to be having more fun. I had a son named Harry who was killed, a rock singer, wrote Cats in the Cradle and Taxi and those things. And so my son Steve is a very successful, by the way, he talked about Weckl. He said, I've had Weckl work for me quite a bit. He's a bass player and a piano player, my son Steve, but mostly a record producer. So he used Steve Gadd a lot, used Weckl a lot. He says, go in the studio, and Steve Gadd, of course, everybody knows about him. He's like the greatest recording artist as far as the drummer, the most competent and all around and inventive. He said, every time Weckl comes in the studio, you know, you expect him to do a great job, but you don't expect anybody to do a job that good, you know. He does a job better. Weckl does a better job than anybody has any right to expect. He's used him about 12 times, you know. So he knows him pretty well. But those guys, they're not lucky so much as they work very hard, but many people work that hard. But they knew that somehow they got in with people that promoted them, you know. And I don't say that there are too many Vinnies or too many Dave Weckls, but there's plenty of guys that you know and I know that are far superior to guys that are making $1 million a year, right? So you can get lucky, very lucky in this business, you know. But the main thing you have to look for, it's more fun than anything, I'm telling you. I chose this. It wasn't thrust on me like it was thrust on Buddy or guys that played all their lives and you get kind of burned out. That's what I'm afraid of. Did you ever hear this kid, Jacob Arman? This kid is a monster, man. He must be he's 9 years old. He must be like Buddy was in vaudeville, because Buddy was a vaudevillian. So when you see these guys, they can hardly play. It must be depressing, you know. The Ringo, of course, in your days, it didn't make any difference. Ringo is still like a folk hero to you guys, but it was very depressing when you heard Ringo Starr being touted as a great drummer, and Dave Clark of the Dave Clark Five, and Charlie Watts. These are nice guys, but they're role players, but they don't play the drums. You know, don't confuse them with being drummers, right, Ralph? You know, they're not even role players. You can't say that. There are characters, you know. That's great, but you know that can be depressing. Don't be depressed, because even if you don't make any money, why, it's a lot of fun. It really is. I mean, I'm telling you, and it's maybe more fun now because you see vague inklings that music's coming back. You know, I heard Omar Hakim. You see, there's nothing wrong with rock. Nothing wrong with rock and roll. Nothing wrong with rock and roll drummers. Nothing wrong with rock and roll bass players. It's that they forgot European harmony in most of it. But you hear a band like Omar Hakim's band. You hear all these great things. They got part of Brazilian harmony, which is really jazz harmony transferred. You know, it's really. But all the forgotten changes, like, you know, we play. This summer I have a summer job, and we play tempos you wouldn't believe. I'm up there and sitting with these guys, and I have a lot of guys come and sit in. So I want to show you what I do, okay? Ralph, come up here. Play me a rock beat.
I have a lot of drummers come out and sit in, right?
I have a lot of drummers that come out there and sit in with me in the summertime. Only a Saturday night in this screaming joint, 2,000 young people, nobody over 30 practically. And I'm there's a big top 40 band inside, and a disco room the size of this, but half again as high, you know? Oh, twice as high. And of course, Ralph plays anything. Ralph's a jazz player, great funk player. I've known him for 20 years, and he studied with me in Wilmington in 72, 73, along there. Right, is that right, Ralph?
I remember you.
Okay. And he's one of the, as I say, he's one of the four or five greatest students I ever had. Others were, yeah. And I'm so glad he's here, because he's like, and I'm so glad you're here too, because we validate each other, you know? He's like, oh, is that right? Is that really right? Look, all these guys are playing pretty fast and pretty strong, and they're pretty good. That old man must know what he's talking about, you know? So, huh? Oh, come on, okay, here we go. About, just play me a rock beat. Oh, back, choke, choke, bang. One of your new song you never heard before. Oh, back, choke, choke, back, choke, dong, back. Oh, go ahead. A little faster, no, a little faster. On back, choke, choke, back, choke. Yeah, I can't show my face, can't go any place. People stop and stare, it's so hard to bear. Everybody knows you've left me. It's the talk of the town. Every time we meet, my heart skips a beat. We don't smoke or speak, though it's just a week. How can love like ours be ended? It's the talk of the town. We sent out invitations to friends and our relations, announcing our wedding day. Friends and our relations sent congratulations. How can you face them? What will you say? Let's make up, sweetheart, but we can't stay apart. Don't let foolish pride keep you from my side. How can love like ours be ended? It's the talk of the town. You got it. Pop. We sent out invitations to friends and our relations, announcing our wedding day. Friends and our relations sent congratulations. How can you face them? What will you say? And let's make up, sweetheart. We can't stay apart. Don't let foolish pride keep you from my side. How can love like ours be ended? It's the talk of the town, baby. It's the talk of the town. Understand, that song is 60 years old if it's a day, right? 55 years old. I think it came out in the early 30s. So they don't, kids don't know. Man, they say, Jesus, I don't know what the old man's doing. We never heard that song before. And they know that after a while they get on to it. You're bringing oldies on it in on us. And we do tough tunes. I do a tune. I'll show you what I do. I do this. Sometimes I have great bass players, and after a while they love to play these tempos, man. They love to. I'm playing tempos like this. Is if nobody's sitting in, because generally if they're sitting in, you know, the tempos are too much for them. And I say, Smile, darn you, smile. Oh, it's not a bad world after all. Smile, darn you, smile. Lady Luck will treat you in her finest style. Things are never bad as they are painted. Time has come for you and me to get acquainted. Make life worthwhile. Come on and smile, darn you, smile. Oh, was not a bad world after all. Smile, darn you, smile. Lady Luck will treat you in her finest style. Things are never bad as they are painted. Time has come for you and me to get acquainted. Make life worthwhile. Come on and smile, darn you, smile, darn you, smile. Darn you, smile. I mean, now, if you want to learn to play jazz, you should do more than I did. You should play all the time with great guys or even guys, but you have to learn the tunes in a way, you know? You make up, sometimes in the old days, there was a drummer named Arthur Herbert. One of the reasons that I got independence was that guy was playing shuffles, you know? Not like modern shuffle, just. So only recently did I really do what I should have done, which was sing and play and sing and play and sing and play. You know, to yourself, in the room. Here's like, because you learn the form of the music. You can play melodies, play recognizable melodies. Just sit there and say, okay, here's a tune everybody knows. All of me, why not take all of me? Can't you see? Want to use them. Take my heart, I'll never use them. You took the part that once was my heart, so why not take all of me? Now listen. Be a good singer. You don't have to be a good singer. I'm a terrible singer, but I know the idiom. You understand? So I mean, when I start to sing those things, I hear Lester Young. I hear. You ever? How many people have heard of Lester Young? Quick. Very good. Lester Young was a maybe. He's the spiritual father of Zoot Sims, Stan Getz, Al Cohen, all these guys started with Lester. They started. They said, listen, oh, let's ball, 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 not like Coltrane, like, or not like Hawkins, like Hawkins, like, calls that, ball, 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 ball. You know, Coltrane had a hard sound. You know, the guys play today. Some of them play pretty, quite pretty, but have a harsher sound. This is the kind of sound Leslie got. Ball, 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 ball. And that's Stan Getz and Zoo Getz sounds like that. Okay. I have procrastinated long enough. Let me get into these things quickly, because otherwise I'm out of here. Huh? Do I have any time yet left? Big five. Well, it's got to go fast. Can I go a little? Can I have maybe 10? All right. Okay. Look, now you understand, I'm going to go through this quickly, you'll see what I mean. Flams are collapsed double strokes. Did you know that? You understand? Does that make sense to you or not? Or would you? Would anybody want to argue with me? Huh? Flam taps are collapsed triples. Say this in here, but they can also be, if you only collapse one side of them, it's five, right? One, two, three, four, five, one, two, one, two, four. Right? So this is very valuable, if you think about it, for funk. Tools. All right. Collapse. I'm afraid I have two of these collapsed paradiddle. I'm quite redundant in this case. I'm repeating myself. But if you collapse a paradiddle, watch what happens. Page, I don't know what the page is, where it says flams or collapsed doubles. Look at the bottom of that page, it says flams or collapsed doubles. You see it? Yeah. Flam triplets, sorry. flam accents. I hate that name. Flam accented triplets is what they should really be, not flam accents. But this is a flam accent too. This is a flam accent. All these things are flam accents. And with flam accented triplets. But you understand that they're just that all I'm doing is running the last two notes into the so. Here's an interesting thing about this. I'm going to play that flam triplet in eighth notes. Listen to what comes out. Bottom of that page, you see at the bottom of that page there? Incidentally, this cymbal company is absolutely delightful. You guys got a whole bunch of Sabian cymbals. Did they lay those cymbals on the place? That's terrific, huh? Huh? They're beautiful, man. I'm sorry, I love them. I've been playing them now for about 3 or 4 years. Bob Zildjian said, "You want to play my cymbals?" And I said, "I'd love to play your cymbals." So he said, "Okay, you're playing my cymbals. Here they are." Turn two pages now and go past this redundant collapse paradiddle. Now, you've all seen this thing from book one. Well, it's a beat that Blakey loved and Max loved, and he said, "Boy, so that's meat and drink to me." Actually, it's just a paradiddle. Elvin, however, loved it, but he couldn't play it very fast because he's basically a head player. He's like, you know, and he's so innovative in that he used his lack of big technique to advantage. Somebody said at one time, "Did you ever notice how a drummer's greatest strength can also be his greatest weakness?" But the same is true in reverse. Because Buddy Rich's greatest strength in the old days was his right foot, man. His hands were very good, but his feet were dynamite. He had a right foot like a quicker than Nico McBrain. Nico McBrain only plays one bass drum, you know. He plays ba-ba-bum, 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 ba-ba-bum. Buddy's foot was like that, except he was a dancer, you know. His feet were absolutely great, like Gadd. Steve Gadd's a dancer, too. If you want to do something smart, if you're really, really, really into this drum, and you want to meet girls, go to tap dancing school sometime, you know? I never did it. I should have done it. I was too old when I knew about it. But boy, you get into tap dancing school, and you're a man, and if there's any other boys there, you don't have to worry about them anyway, you know? Because they're looking at each other, maybe looking at you. But if you're going there as a tap dancer, and you're straight, and these little girls look at you tap dancing and say, "Oh, isn't he beautiful," you know? but really, just think what it is. Just think what it is. I mean, Buddy, did you ever see Buddy play the bass drums? Buddy played. He played all. He played like sideways. Played with his toe up, down, and up. He played way up in here sometimes. He didn't care anything he did. He slipped with his heel up. Yeah. Broke his arm. Broke his arm at night. I talked to him 3 days before. I got to tell you this. 3 days before he died, Morello called me up, and I got to tell you. I'll tell you a story. Morello called me up and said, "Buddy wants to talk to you." I said, "What do you mean Buddy wants to talk to you?" He said, "Well, how's Jimmy? Well, I'd like to hear from Jimmy, you know?" And so I said, "Okay, Joe, you got his number?" "Yeah, he's not staying at home." He said, "Okay." So I called him in California. And he said, I said, How you feel, Buddy?" He said, "Jimmy, baby, terrible, terrible baby, terrible man. Can't make it. My left side, he's dead. Yeah, no good. No good, man, no good." I said, well, left side, buddy, that shouldn't be any problem for you. Remember 1948 at the Paramount? I said, broke your arm playing with this big band at the Paramount, right? Before, I think it was 48. No, his own band. His own band. He was a leader. He had to do all, everything, you know. He's with the arm in the sling. He's playing solos and everything. You know, he had his bass drum wasn't like a third hand. It was like, I mean, he played. You know, everything going like mad. And I said, shouldn't be any problem for you. So Freddie Gruber, who was his very good friend, told me that the next day, I mean, it wasn't just me, other people must have said, you're going to be all right, buddy. You know, your left side, oh, you need your left side. He called the band up a day and a half before he died. Said, get the band together. He called the manager up in New York. He said, get the band together. We're going on the road. And I didn't call it indomitable. That's indomitable. I got so many Buddy Rich stories. I'm sorry. I can't tell you them all, but he was incredible because he was like, you never listen to what he said, you know. I never studied, never practiced, and it just comes from, it's like, he wanted to be like springing full arm from the brow of Zeus, like Athena, you know. Well, it wasn't like that. So, what was I talking about? Oh, so this is, now Elvin, talking about Elvin. His greatest strength, I got back to it, oh boy. Buddy's greatest strength was also his greatest weakness. Because he bashed the bass drum. Here's the way he used to play in those days. You never heard any blend in the rhythm section. That was the Count Basie's. The Count Basie band was the first band where you heard the bass and the guitar and everything. Because Joe Jones played the bass drum like this. Not, but Buddy played like, you know, really took, you know. So his greatest strength was also his greatest weakness. The opposite way around, Elvin couldn't, where this is a case where his greatest weakness was also his greatest strength. Elvin could not play fast. So I'll give you two examples of it. The first is how Elvin became polyrhythmic. They say, Elvin's polyrhythmic, man. Elvin's polyrhythmic. Well, here's what he was doing. Now, look at this bottom of this page, right? I'll explain the middle of the page. But what this thing is really, I told you, they're all collapsed, something or else, all these rudiments and all these little patterns, if they're overlapped, they got flams in them, they're all some different family that you don't understand, you know. You see them over at the right-hand side where it says seven-stroke roll starting with the tap. Collapsed is a paraflittle-diddle. Now here's the way it's played. Here's the way it was supposed to be played. And now I'm doing it forward. I mean, actually, it's turned around, but it works better when it's doing. That's that. You see the page I'm talking about now? Yeah, you got it there. It says in the middle of the page, seven-stroke roll starting with the tap. Collapse is a paraflittle-diddle. It's my own word. It's complicated, but that's what it is. Now watch, you see where it says the line right in the middle of the page with says 7-7-6-6-6 equals 32. Well, look at the line below that says interrelationships in the Elvin Jones beat. Now, all you have to know is that the bottom two bars, if you played by a machine, would sound exactly the same. You program on the drum machine, those bottom two lines, or the bottom four, you know, the bottom sequence, if played on the drum machine, would sound exactly the same, and I'm going to be the drum machine. See the bottom of that page I'm talking about now? All right. They're going to play paraflittle-diddle. In fact, I'm going to have somebody come up and play it for you, for me, and they can show you can be Elvin Jones, okay, in a minute. Paraflittle-diddle, paraflittle-diddle, paraflittle-diddle. Right, I'll play it, and you'll hear the here. If you know Elvin Jones at all, you'll hear right there. Not the sound of it, not the feel of Elvin Jones, but the bare bones. You understand? Now I'm playing those three bars over and over. You understand those three bars that says ba 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 on the top, understand? And the left hand's doing the answers. You understand what I'm talking about? The bottom of that page there. You see it? You see it? Okay. Now I'm gonna stop my bass drum, change my bass drum, and then you're gonna see the bottom bar, bottom two bars. I'm playing the bottom first three bars, top three bars. Then I'm going to tell you what I'm going to start with. Okay, well, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Want to switch back? Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Now I'm going to sing against that. Now I'm going to show you, there's a lot more to this than meets the eye, because you can go right through the whole pattern. Now you can start off paraf little diddle, do two more of them, and then you got in triplets, and then you go to 16th notes. He doesn't do that, but it's very interesting to do that. But you can see now, if I sing, I'm going to try and sing a little. I don't know what I'll sing at that tempo, but here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Ba 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 ba. Bo 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 ba ba bo ba 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 ba. Bo 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 ba 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 do be da ba ba. Ba da ba da ba ba da bo ba 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 do be da ba ba ba. Ba da ya ba 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 da ya ba ba bo ba 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 bo ba bo ba 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 ba. Ba 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 do ba. Ba 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 ba. See what it is? It's that note, that beat in eighth notes. He couldn't do it fast enough to do it like this, like Max and Art did. Ah. He made something new and better out of it, you know. Did you ever hear him play a fast tempo? Elvin play a fast tempo? Watch what he does in the fast tempo. He couldn't play ding any more than he flies. What'd he do? Things like diddle para diddle diddle para diddle para diddle. Diddle para diddle diddle para diddle. Hey. Is it better? And look, and then a left hand para diddle. The double stroke. He helped me a lot. Helped me a lot just to know that, because I could play those tempos great, but it was not. Sometimes I want to get out of that groove this summer. I didn't want to play. But you got to be on it, you know. You want to have a little rest for a while, you know. Okay, everybody's going to go in a second, but I just got one more little thing to do. I'm procrastinating like mad. Okay, now, yeah. Huh? Okay, fine. Are you going to use it again tonight? You using it tonight? Okay. Okay, can I have 2 minutes? All right, 2 minutes. Now, remember I told you about the Swiss triplet? Say the formation of the Swiss triplets. Look at it. For instance, if I do it in triplets, it's the top line. Now I'm going to do it in eighth note. Great tool for fusion. All I'm doing is double stroke roll, some of them overlap.
is if you look, formation of the Swiss triplets, mode, triplet mode in eighth notes. Now it doesn't have to start on the beat, this is on. Start 1/8 note too soon now. But this can also be turned into this. Another one can be turned into this, remember? Just raise the right hand. Tools of fusion that some people know, and they say, "How the hell did he do that?" And that's some of the times that's what the thing they're doing, things like that you didn't know about yet, you know. Now, you know, this thing down here is a funk beat built entirely on Swiss on collapsed doubles. Listen. Hear it? That is 4/4. That's what it is. Da 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 da. And on the other hand, answering it in a different way, overlapped a couple of times. And this now this one. The last one on the page. Hear it? It's fairly simple. Let me race on and get out of here. All right. This side, it's all the Swiss triplet things. I don't know if you saw me did. I was doing things like this before. I look at the Swiss triplet and some related techniques, you know. Either my left hand's doing this. If I do the first one there. The first one that I have that says right or left down below. You can look at the second group of lines. And so you play any of these three things. Just remember that, like I did that thing with the I did do the shuffle. Now, but you can also do it like this. The shuffle is no problem. It's just and then you can put this in. Keep that thing going. You can do all kinds of things around it, and then use that as part of a double stroke, for instance, or part of the Swiss triplet. Or now is the second one here is the old answer one we do. And then this one here. Good night. Ed, take it easy, Ed. Good to see you. I got to leave tomorrow. I got to get the noon plane. I guess you better get there at dawn, right? Here we go. Now, this is strange, but it works very well, isn't it? That part of the Swiss triplet. Let me see. Oh well. I want you to understand that this is first line in the next thing. If you see this thing with this very busy thing, I just going backwards in a way. This very busy page here, the rolls on the last page of the thing. See it? Don't tell me I got almost through this thing, isn't it? How is that possible? I'm sorry. I'm sorry I inflicted so much talk on you, but. I want you to understand. There's a lot of stuff here to work on, and if you you don't think that you have to learn all this in a bunch. I give this out, and some of my students never come back for a year. You know, I give this out the first lesson, and they don't understand that I expect this to be an ongoing thing, not something you're supposed to woodshed and do now. This is like a study of 3 or 4 or 5 years. I still go back to this stuff when I want. You know, most of the stuff I wrote myself, but it's derivative of the things I've been doing and the things that other people have been doing. It's not all mine. But most of the collapse things, the idea that the collapse things, I've been doing about 20 years. Other guys are onto them now because I've been passing this out for a long time, and I never did complete book 3. So Dom Famular is going to kill me if I don't do it, because he's after me. All he's got me by the throat. Who do you think is responsible for that video? That's his. You see the video when you came in? Him talking there. That was him. you could recognize him. Recognize his voice. Yeah. Okay. Now look at this. Just look at the top line of this last page. Then you realize I'm not going to do the whole thing. I just want to show you what it really is. The top line is the rhythm, right? And if you see any of those Charlie Wilcoxon books, you don't know whether they're supposed to be played because they're written like this. You don't know whether they're supposed to be played like this. No. The only thing you know that it's not supposed to be. All eighth notes, nothing else but eighth notes, doubled up. So the first would be. Second would be. And the third would be, could be the top line if you played it in a certain way, but this is the way it really would sound. Sound like A, B, C. You see the bottom line that with that sticking on there? Well, it's the same thing, but it's all triplets. Why is it all triplets? It's still this. Because they're phrased that way. Now, that's the way it would sound fast. So I'll play it down fast, and I'll get out. I know. I'll let him go. Listen, you understand that. I've explained sort of the phrasing thing. I think it's true. Thank you very much for staying around. And I appreciate your coming very much. Thank you. And I hope I didn't bore you to death with all this stuff, because there's so much stuff that you have to get, I wanted to get going. I'm not going to be back here for a while.